Good evening. Welcome to American Pie 2023. I just want to thank all of you for being a part of preserving the history and legacy of our cherished program. Without the unbridled enthusiasm of a very special group of young people that we have, and a very special group of people in the audience, and your continued support, without that, this show would simply not be possible. Thank you. History is an ongoing continuum accompanied by an incredible range of events that have left permanent impressions on each of our lives, some good, some not so good. The immediacy of music and its ability to become seemingly timeless has enabled us to provide the narrative of our lives. So let us all step away from the demands of the reality we call life for a brief time and enjoy this thing we call American Pie. And now I will leave you with our guide through music and history, Karen Allen.
Hello, everyone. I believe it's time to turn back the clock and turn up the volume. As the United States emerged from World War II, the expected relief of homecoming soldiers and the reunion of families would be all too brief. The battles of the war had ended, but the conflict took on a new identity in the shape of what would come to be known as the Cold War. An overt threat by the Soviet Union to force its communist ideologies on the free nations of the world would leave the United States with no choice but to lead the effort to preserve the free world, fighting in a brief but deadly conflict in Korea, and eventually a more protracted military affair in Vietnam. Against a backdrop of the second Red Scare, most Americans, including the emerging generation of teenagers, were enjoying the post-war economic prosperity. Though still in its infancy and disdained by most adults, rock and roll was rapidly working its way into American society in the 1950s. A hybrid of blues and country music, with horn elements borrowed from jazz thrown in for good measure, its stripped down sound and hypnotic beat were too much for America's youth to resist. Kicking off tonight's show, the American Pie Band will perform the often covered 1951 hit, Night Train.
Thank you.
Now singing the Penguins' 1954 classic Earth Angel, Our King in Burbrink, supported by Austin Clark, Jacob Streidelmeier, and Ben Richards. Youthful-looking John F. Kennedy as the President of the United States brought with it much optimism and the hope of a national youth movement. The new frontier, the theme of the Kennedy administration, made many promises of improvement and prosperity, but was weighed down by a sluggish economy, slower than promised progress and civil rights, serious military showdowns involving neighboring Cuba, and the heart-wrenching assassination of President Kennedy himself. Despite the negative events of the time, the suburbs would be the domain of hula hoops, stingray bicycles, Little League baseball, and the popular station wagon. Family life would be represented by wholesome television programs such as Father Knows Best and Leave It to Beaver. Fathers were white-collar workers who always wore suits, and mothers maintained the domestic bliss of home life all the while wearing dresses and high-heeled shoes. The moral of each episode was that missteps made by the children could and would ultimately be corrected by obeying the wisdom and advice of their parents. The innocence of this period of the early 1960s would be expressed in songs like The Shirelles, Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow, performed by Vanessa Holloway with Paisley James, Kate Franklin, and Caroline Andrus. Welcome Ben Richards, Jacob Streetelmeyer, Austin Clark, Frankie Poliak, and Fisher Mantooth to perform Surfin' Safari by the Beach Boys.
Set your minds. Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
Early in the morning we'll be starting now. Some honeys will be coming along. We're loading up our woody with our boards inside and heading out singing our song.
Come on, baby, you surfing in safari. Learning how, come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
From Huntington to Malibu, they're shooting the pier. At Ringtone, they're walking the nose. We're going on safari to the island this year. So if you're coming, get ready to go.
Come on, baby, you surf in the sea.
Yes, I'm gonna take you
surf in safari.
Well, come along now, baby.
Go surfing now, everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me. Learning how, come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
Surf a safari,
yeah, I'm surf a safari. Surf a safari,
yeah, I'm
surf a safari.
Surf a safari,
yeah, I'm
surf a safari.
Surf a safari.
Ladies and gentlemen, with the Beatles, She Loves You is the American Pie Chorus. Organized sports were a prominent feature of American culture, beginning with the tremendous growth of industrialization and therefore American cities. The cities would motivate a migration of disillusioned rural youth who would help shape a new urban culture that thrived on entertainment and excitement. Industrial work provided steady wages and a day off from work, something that did not exist on the farm. Two sports in particular, baseball and football, began drawing large numbers of spectators during this time. Baseball introduced professionalism to American sports in 1869, helping to establish it as America's pastime. By the 1960s, baseball expanded the number of franchise teams to meet the demands of an increasing number of fans, but would soon begin to feel competition for spectators from professional football. By 1966, plans were made to have a major championship played by the winner of the National Football League and the winner of the rival American Football League. Scheduled for January of 1967, an American tradition, the Super Bowl, would debut, and the rest is history. Also from 1967 is Can't Take My Eyes Off of You, recorded by Frankie Valli of the Four Seasons. It'll be performed by Colby Lovins.
Thank you.
Here's another hit from 1967 by Tommy James and the Shondells. I Think We're Alone Now. Performing will be Austin Weber, backed by Olive Mantooth and Annie Miller. Historically, events of the late 60s were a range of opposites: tragedy and triumph, violence and peace, social consciousness and cynical indifference. For all its great intentions, President Lyndon Johnson's war on poverty could not keep pace with the angry, impatient society that had not gotten great yet. The violent assassinations of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Robert Kennedy in 1968 and the riots and arrests throughout America were examples of the tragedy. While the first moon landing in 1969 granted us the opportunity to witness great progress and the fulfillment of John F. Kennedy's promise, the yin and yang of Woodstock and Altamont, peace and violence. The establishment of Earth Day in April 1970 would remind us that some people were actually thinking of the future. As evidenced by the next three songs, popular music seemed to be somewhat immune to the influence of the contemporary events and succeeded in standing by itself for what it was: likable melodies and catchy lyrics. Elvis Presley, lauded for his ability to interpret any type of song, would provide us with If I Can Dream in 1968, and it will be sung tonight by Frankie Poliak with Fisher Mantooth and King and Bergbrink.
Thank you. I can dream of a better land where all my brothers walk hand in hand. Tell me why, oh why won't my dream come true? Oh why? There must be peace and understanding. That will blow away the doubt and fear. If I can dream of a warmer sun where hope keeps shining on everyone, tell me why, oh why, oh why won't that sun appear? We're lost.
Originally called Chicago Transit Authority, conflict with the public transportation system required shortening the name to simply Chicago. A centerpiece from their debut album, Does Anybody Really Know What Time It Is, will be brought to you tonight by Richards Elementary teacher Jeff Bray, with his daughter Molly Bray, Jenny Gaffron, and Jerry Myhay.
That's for the short guy.
Jerry, you can go one to your right, your left. Sorry. Go
down. You want me to go one to my left too?
Yeah. Yep.
One to my left. I'm walking.
That one.
That one. That left.
That's a
mic for a tall guy. All right, we're good. Yeah.
One day, a man came up to me and asked me what the time was. That was on my watch. Yeah, that's it. Yes, I said, does anybody really know what time it is? Does anybody really care
about time?
If so, I can't imagine why.
Oh no,
we've all got time enough to cry. As I was walking down the street one day, a pretty lady looked at me and said her time and watch had stopped, go dead. Yeah, and I said, does anybody really know what time it is? Imagine why.
Oh, no.
We've all got time enough to cry. And I was walking down the street one day, being pushed and shoved by people trying to beat the clock. Oh, no, I just don't know. I don't know. I don't know. And I said, yes, I imagine why.
Oh, no.
We've all got time enough to die. Everybody's working.
No.
I don't care
about time.
About time.
Oh, no.
I don't care.
'69's Venus by The Shocking Blue hinted at an invasion attempt by Dutch pop groups and would be covered tonight by Kate London, accompanied by her brother Charlie London on lead guitar.
Thank you.
As the decade of the 1960s became the 1970s, there was a definite sense of change. The shock of the counterculture had pretty much lost its effect by the beginning of the 1970s, and mainstream culture reflected at the very least a noticeable acceptance of what had previously been the focus of scorn. Having won his case in the Supreme Court, Muhammad Ali returned to the boxing ring in time to salvage part of his career. Muscle cars of the 60s would be eliminated through a combined effort by the government and exorbitant insurance premiums. Ever-increasing fuel costs resulted in an emphasis on fuel economy, with performance being nothing more than a fond memory. Car enthusiasts would suffer a temporary loss of identity while maintaining an ongoing hope that Detroit would one day resurrect the glory and indulgence of fast cars. In 1972, President Richard Nixon traveled to the People's Republic of China to confer with Chairman Mao Zedong, busting a long-held myth of a Chinese alliance with the Soviet Union. A subsequent trip to the Soviet Union later that year would initiate a relaxation of tensions between the superpowers. James Taylor would come to personify a new generation of performers who would bridge the gap between folk and pop music. Taylor's music would evolve over time, and his career has continued well into the 2000s. Tonight, Fisher Mantooth will be singing Taylor's composition, Fire and Rain.
Just yesterday morning, they let me know you were gone. Suzanne, the plans they made put an end to you. I walked out this morning and I wrote down this song. I just can't remember who to send it to. And I've seen fire and I've seen rain. Seen sunny days that I thought would never end. I've seen lonely times when I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you again. Won't you look down upon me, Jesus? You gotta help me make a stand. You've just got to see me through another day. My body's aching and my time is at hand. And I won't make it any other way. Oh, I've seen fire and I've seen rain. I've seen sunny days that I thought would never end. Seen lonely times when I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you again. Been walking my mind through an easy time, my back turned towards the sun. Lord knows when the cold wind blows, it'll turn your head around. Well, there's hours of time on the telephone line to talk about things to come. Sweet dreams and flying machines and pieces on the ground. Oh, I've seen fire and I've seen rain. I've seen sunny days that I thought would never end. I've seen lonely times when I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you, baby, one more time again now. Thought I'd see you one more time again. a few things coming my way this time around now. Thought I'd see you, thought I'd see you fire and rain now.
Hello, thank you. A group of young men from Florida who called themselves the Allman Brothers would build their reputation by playing blues music with a sense of conviction and sophistication well beyond their years. Tragedy would strike the band on the cusp of its major success, claiming first the life of lead guitarist and band visionary Dwayne Allman in a motorcycle accident, followed by the loss of bassist Barry Oakley in a second motorcycle accident, almost a year to date from Allman's. Amazingly, the band showed its resilience and became one of America's biggest bands by the mid-70s. Now welcome American Pie alum Reuben Guthrie singing an Allman Brothers rendition of blues man Sonny Boy Williamson's One Way Out.
Check one. Second floor, if I get by this time, I'll away. Ain't no way in the world I'm going out that front door. Cause there's a man down there, might be your man, I don't know. Cause there's a man down there, might be your man, I don't know. Cause there's a man down there, Lord, it might just happen to be your man. Thank you kindly.
Yeah, feedback.
Women in America had been actively asserting their influence since the days of Abigail Adams, Martha Washington, and Dolly Madison. Undeterred by setbacks such as the angry backlash from the Seneca Falls Convention of 1848 and exclusion from the 15th Amendment, American women would finally achieve the right to vote in 1920 with the 19th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. Sadly, women did not turn out to vote as expected, the victims of tradition and male dominance. As reality dictates, true independence is economic, and World War II provided the very opportunity for women to become economically independent. The work of Eleanor Roosevelt during her husband's administration and affirmative action efforts by John F. Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson in the 1960s maintained the momentum. A revitalized women's movement would yield results such as Title IX legislation in 1972. This would provide a tremendous number of opportunities for female students and athletes. That same year, singer Helen Reddy would release a popular song, I Am Woman, and proclaim, "Hear me roar in numbers too big to ignore." In 1973, Billie Jean King would defeat a confident but over-the-hill Bobby Riggs in a tennis match known as the Battle of the Sexes. To honor these achievements, our next four songs will feature successful female artists from the mid-70s. First will be Olivia Newton-John's first entry into the American charts, Let Me Be There, sung by Lucy Wilson with Natalie Cantu and Fisher Mantooth.
Catch you when you fall.
Next is the Dolly Parton gem, Jolene, sung by Nora Tame, with Danny Riley, Annie Green, Molly Hotek, and Elizabeth Aldifer. Singing ABBA's Dancing Queen, please welcome Columbus North World Language teacher Rebecca Burbrink and her daughter Ava Burbrink. Singer Kiki D's collaboration with Sir Elton John, Don't Go Breaking My Heart, will be performed this evening by Elaney Parker and Austin Clark.
Yeah. I'd like to take a moment and introduce our outstanding horn section for tonight. Our saxophones are Riley England, Luke Dornfeld, Andrew McLean, King and Burbrink, and Connor Hoffman, saxophones. Our trombones tonight, Sophie Hill, Santi DeLuna, and our good friend Brian Munoz. And our trumpets back there, Tyler Martin, Will Stinner, Abby Shute, and Johan Peters.
Nixon, Ford, and Carter sounds like the name of a rock supergroup of the 70s. In reality, these were the three American presidents faced with a decade of problems and general dissatisfaction. Richard Nixon demonstrated his resolve in successful foreign policy events like his epic 1972 trip to China first, and then later in the same year, a trip to the Soviet Union. The peace accord with North Vietnam in 1973 raised hopes and expectations of a less stressful time for all, only to be dashed by the effects of a Middle East oil embargo against the United States, along with high inflation rates, low wages, and increasing unemployment. Nixon's scandalous Watergate affair gave Americans a unique, albeit disturbing, occurrence in history. The first presidential resignation from office and America's first unelected president. Gerald Ford would inherit a weak economy and a lot of public anger. His good guy image would simply not be enough to get him reelected. Jimmy Carter represented a step away from the politics of Washington, D.C., a viewpoint shared by many Americans at the time. The same anemic economy experienced by his predecessors would plague Carter during his entire presidency. His Washington outsider status only worked against him, as he did not enjoy much political success, even within his own party. The humanitarian efforts of his post-presidency will certainly ensure him a more important place in American presidential history. Stevie Wonder was a hitmaker and known to most as a child prodigy recording star for Motown Records in the 1960s. He would produce a string of critically acclaimed albums in the 1970s that would allow him to eclipse his past success and establish him as an artist of the highest regard. Tonight, the American Pie Horns will perform their arrangement of Stevie's I Wish.
Thank you.
By the later 1970s, popular music was characterized by a general indifference to social issues while gaining a harder edge and attitude. American youth seemed more focused on hedonism and excessive indulgence. This would be demonstrated by our next two songs. First off is Aerosmith's Same Old Song and Dance, brought to life by 1979 Columbus North graduate Kevin Silva.
Thank you.
with Toto's Hold the Line, Kate Russell with Connor Cheek, Rebecca Simon, and Maggie Bailey. Benatar's Heartbreaker will be performed by American Pie veteran Molly Hotek.
Oh. you know that you have all to win. You're a heartbreaker, dream maker, love taker. Don't you mess around with me. You're a heartbreaker, dream maker, love taker. Don't you mess around with me. You're a heartbreaker, dream maker, love taker. Don't you mess around with me. You're a heartbreaker, dream maker, love taker. Heartbreaker.
Ladies and gentlemen, with a pair of Pink Floyd classics, two American Pie legends, Mr. Greg Hedges and Mr. Jerry Myhay.
Anybody out there
we gotta pee.
Rounding out this set of music will be Blondie's Call Me, Amelia Maddox, and Colby Lovins.
Y'all ready for some Blondie?
The 1980s were characterized by positive changes, a welcome departure from the pessimism of the 1970s. Fun would actually experience a major resurgence. Music broke away from tradition due in large part to the technological advances made available by the digital age. This resulted in a wider variety of musical styles and large-scale mega events such as the Live Aid and Farm Aid series of fundraisers. Fashion designer and 1971 Columbus High School graduate Stephen Sprouse would be among the vanguard of 1980s art and visual expressionists, supplying wardrobe designs to many of the stars of the day. Vice President George H.W. Bush had reason to feel confident in winning his own presidency in 1988, with the American population in a general mood of comfort and satisfaction. In January of 1991, Operation Desert Storm, a multinational military coalition led by the United States, would successfully liberate Kuwait from an invasion by neighboring Iraq. By 1992, though, the population quickly became forgetful of Bush's foreign policy achievements, instead focusing concern on a stalled economy. When solutions weren't forthcoming or timely enough, voters willingly elected William Jefferson Clinton as President of the United States in 1992. Despite high hopes and a new president, the nation would experience some of the darkest days of modern history throughout the decade. Columbine, Waco, Oklahoma City, what more need we say? In addition, a failed attempt to destroy the World Trade Center would be a preview of what was to come. Clinton would enjoy a relatively easy re-election in 1996, but early in 1999 would suffer the indignity of becoming the second American president to be impeached by Congress. In spite of the scandal, he would leave office with high approval ratings equal to predecessors such as Franklin Roosevelt and Ronald Reagan. Meanwhile, rock music would not stand still, ever moving forward with an anything-goes attitude that would yield a trove of diverse musical styles, from the flannel shirt anthems of grunge, the emphasis of rock sounds in country music, urban rap music, and the distinct musical departure of alternative. From the archives of the 90s, we give to you a crossover hit from Alanna Miles, Black Velvet, presented to you by Columbus North Choir director Jenny Gaffron with Molly Hotek and Ella Fisher.
could you do?
So far, we've all heard a lot of really wonderful sounds from this stage. So I'm going to introduce a few of these people. You may or you may not know them, but if you don't, you will. On acoustic guitar over there, Mr. Dan Mustard. Probably the most legit guy of the bunch of us. Also on guitar, Columbus North, Machine Trades, teacher extraordinaire, guitarist Dalton Foley. Our guest with the long silver locks that plays a mean Les Paul from Indianapolis, Indiana, Kevin Silva. This young man's quickly become one of my favorites, Columbus North student, Colby Lovins. On keyboards, a guy that I used to watch before I even started playing guitar. We're privileged to have him and all of his experience many years playing in this very show, Mr. Danny Clark. And over on the far side, a guy you see occasionally, he's also doing dual duty, mixing the monitors and playing keyboards, Mr. Bruce Zehring. On bass guitar, my longtime musical cohort, Mr. Greg A. Hedges. And the wild man perched up there on the drum throne and drum riser, Columbus East graduate, 1976. We won't hold that against him, no. Rakish Dave Maris.
Please welcome Columbus North math guru Mike Spock. He's going to bring you Ice Ice Baby with some special assistance from Ella Fisher, Bree Guthrie, Sarah Gross, Annie Miller, and Carolina Dominguez.
Baby!
Finishing out this set with a song 1979 by Smashing Pumpkins will be Columbus North English teacher David Spencer.
Stone.
Well, as it is about that time. A lot of folks may be unaware, but there are so many things going on behind the scenes to make this event happen. It is, what you see is a wonderful thing, but it would not be what it is if it were not for a special group of people that we have that are doing other things. Carol Dingledye could not be here tonight. Her husband had a medical procedure, and she needed to be where she needed to be. But Carol has worked for the entire last year promoting this show on social media. She's sometimes driving me crazy, wanting new stuff to put up, and we get it to her as fast as we can. But she's been a wellspring of ideas and been associated with this show for many, many years, and I hope she will be in the future as well. Artwork, the students do this, their own work. They design the posters, the programs, the logos, the shirts. All this stuff comes from them, and they are directed by Leslie Weaver. Wonderful artwork. We're blessed with a wonderful printing department, currently led by Jeff Metz. He's got a wonderful partner helping him, Sandy Kent. They've just done an absolute wonderful job. Nova Ohm actually designed this poster and program, so thank you to those folks. We have a new auditorium director, Justine Likens. She kind of had an idea what she was getting into with us, and then she realized just how crazy we are. Thank you, Justine. Of course, our horn section led by the one and only Mr. Keith Burton. Yeah. Our sound production, if you like the sound, it's because this young man is very talented in this profession. His name is Jacob Zering. I've got a couple more folks that are special and dear to me in what they've done. I'm sad that one of us will be departing, and that is Jennifer Gaffron, a wonderful, wonderful musician and choir director and singer and just source of professionalism. Jennifer, we're going to miss you. A few years back, I was approached by a person who wanted to get involved with this show. For many years, she had been one of my best customers for tickets, loved to come to the show, and she said, I want to get involved, I want to help. And I couldn't ask for more from this person. She's really gone out there and gotten us some sponsorship that has just been a wonderful assist to us. Coors Family Eye Care, Family Chiropractic and Wellness, Frank's Tree Care, but Karen Allen, folks, our narrator and your hostess. As we know, this is a celebration of rock and roll. And we're going to close this evening with a song that just says that. I love rock and roll. Joan Jett.